French Revolution is a pivotal event that shook the very foundations of French society, having a profound impact on the world as we know it. It marked the end of the old nobility and the beginning of a new era of democracy, equality, and human rights. It was a time of great upheaval as the old order was violently dismantled and a new order was established in its place. The French Revolution changed the course of history and set the stage for the modern world that we live in today.
At its core, the revolution was a response to a variety of factors that had been building up for decades. One of the most significant of these factors was the growing debt of the French crown. France was one of the most wealthiest and most powerful nations in Europe during the 18th century. However, its government was heavily involved in the economy, controlling prices and production through regulations and tariffs. This system was expensive, and the French government struggled to pay for its expenditures. To finance these expenses, the government began borrowing heavily, which led to a growing national debt. Involvement in various wars, including the Seven Years' War and the American Revolutionary War, further exacerbated the debt problem. These conflicts drained France's resources and put further pressure on the treasury. The high debt had severe consequences for the French population. To pay off the debt, the government simply printed more money, which led to high inflation. Prices for goods and services skyrocketed, making it difficult for the average person to afford basic necessities. This high inflation was especially damaging to the rural population, who depended on fixed prices for their crops. The food shortages were further worsened by poor harvests in the 1770s and 80s, which led to famine and starvation. The French population was already struggling with high inflation and low wages, and the food shortages made life even more difficult. Many people began to demand action for the government to address these issues, but the French monarchy was unable to provide relief. This helped to create a sense of desperation and resentment among the population, which fueled the desire for change. Enlightenment thought and philosophy played a significant role in the French Revolution. The Enlightenment was a cultural and intellectual movement that emerged in the 18th century, emphasizing reason, individualism, and the pursuit of happiness. Enlightenment thinkers argued that individuals should have the right to control their own lives, and that the government should be accountable to its citizens. These ideas quickly spread in the so-called public sphere, in coffee shops, cafes, and Masonic lodges. They resonated with the French population, who were frustrated with the crown's failure to address their needs. Many people began to demand more rights for individuals and greater political participation. The French Revolution was fueled by these desires for change, as well as by these economic and social factors. In 1789, King Louis XVI of France called the Estates General together for the first time in 150 years to deal with the financial crisis. The Estates General was made up of three groups of people: the First Estate, the Second Estate, and the Third Estate. Each estate got one vote, and they made choices based on the most votes. However, the Estates General was biased towards the rich and powerful. The First Estate was made up of clergy members, like priests and bishops. They only made up 1% of the population, but owned 10% of the land in France. They didn't have to pay taxes and got special treatment, like being allowed to hold public jobs and use their own court system. The Second Estate was made up of nobility, like counts and knights. They made up 2% of the population and owned about 20% of the land. They also didn't have to pay taxes and got privileges like the right to hunt, carry a sword, and hold exclusive titles and jobs. The Third Estate was the biggest group, with about 97% of the population. It included peasants, city workers, and the middle class. They paid most of the taxes and had very few rights and privileges. Even though they had more people, they were always outvoted by the First and Second Estates, since each estate only had one vote. Some people, like Abbe Emmanuel Joseph Sieyès, didn't like how the Estates General worked. He thought the Third Estate should have more say since they paid most of the taxes. Abbe Sieyès' family said, "What is the Third Estate? Everything. What has it been until now within the political order? Nothing. What does it want to be? Something." The three groups couldn't agree on anything, so the National Assembly was created in 1789. The Third Estate was mad about not having a say, so they declared themselves as the National Assembly. Some members from the other two estates left to join them. The creation of the National Assembly was a step towards more democracy and giving more power to regular people. King Louis XVI didn't like this new National Assembly and locked them out of their meeting room. They instead went to a tennis court nearby and swore the tennis court oath. They promised to keep meeting until they had written a new constitution for France. The tennis court oath proved that the Third Estate was serious about making changes and wanted to break away from the old way of doing things. The events of July 1789 marked the beginning of a long struggle for the ideas of the burgeoning revolution, as the people of France rose and took action to defend the revolution. Throughout the summer, Louis XVI did things that people interpreted as counter-revolutionary. He sent 30,000 troops to Paris to keep order and replaced key government figures with people who were against the revolution. When he fired Jacques Necker, a friend of the Third Estate, it set off the spark of the revolution. On July 14th, a big crowd of people gathered outside the Bastille. The Bastille was a symbol of the monarchy's power and oppression in Paris. The people wanted the governor to let the prisoners go, but he refused. The crowd got angry and pushed their way inside. After several hours, the revolutionaries won and took control of the Bastille. The governor and his men were killed. The victory, in the eyes of the revolutionaries, represented the end of the monarchy's absolute power and the beginning of a new era of democracy and freedom in France. After the fall of the Bastille, there was a time of anxiety and unrest called the Great Fear. Farmers were afraid that counter-revolutionary famine plots planned by the aristocracy were happening all over the country. This made the peasants fearful, and they formed local militias to defend themselves and the National Assembly against what they saw as a threat. They looted and ransacked rich estates and abbeys and monasteries. By August, the National Assembly was able to calm things down by proposing the unthinkable idea of abolishing the nobility's privileges.
Following the massive peasant revolts that had swept the French countryside, the National Assembly gathered to discuss the issue of property. The Assembly decided to create the August Decrees, abolishing the feudal system which had long been a source of social and economic inequality in France. The decrees abolished the privileges of the nobility and the clergy. The nobility and the clergy had enjoyed a wide range of privileges, privileges now defunct. The decrees also abolished tithes, removing a major income source for the Catholic Church in France. The Assembly published the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen. The declaration was first drafted by Lafayette, known for his participation with the American revolutionaries in the 1770s. As a result, the document was influenced by the American Declaration of Independence. The declaration declared that people have the right to life, liberty, property, and security. It also asserted the freedom of religion, due process of law, and the right to resist oppression. However, the declaration was limited to male property owners over the age of 25, women and foreigners were not included.
The harsh economic conditions that affected the people of France reached their breaking point by late 1789. The women of Paris, who were responsible for buying and preparing food for their families, were particularly affected by the shortage and high cost of bread. As the situation worsened, the women decided to take matters into their own hands. On the morning of October 5th, a group of women began to march to Versailles. The crowd soon swelled to around 7,000 people. The marchers were armed with makeshift weapons such as kitchen knives, pikes, and muskets. They were determined to confront their king and demand justice for their suffering. When the crowd arrived at the Palace of Versailles, they elected six people to have an audience with King Louis XVI, allowing them into the palace to present their grievances. Louis XVI promised the delegation the arrival of bread and flour from the palace inventories to Paris. Tensions were calmed when Lafayette and the National Guard had Louis address the crowd on a balcony. The king decided to relocate to Paris, and he and his family left the palace that same night. They were to take up residence in the Tuileries Palace, where they would be under the watchful eye of the National Guard and the Assembly. The August Decrees and the Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen had limited the influence of the Catholic Church in France significantly. but the civil constitution of the clergy, perhaps one of the more ill-judged, controversial, and destructive laws of the French Revolution, would see the assembly sever ties with Rome outright. The most significant blow to the Catholic Church in France was the passage of the civil constitution of the clergy in July 1790. This law nationalized the Catholic Church in France and made it subject to the state. Bishops and priests would be appointed by the state, no longer by the Pope in Rome. The law required all bishops and priests to take an oath of loyalty to the new government, which many refused to do. This led to a schism within the church, with some priests and bishops supporting the new government and others remaining loyal to Rome. Following the Women's March on Versailles, Louis XVI and his family were effectively prisoners at the Tuileries Palace. The royal family eventually decided to escape. The plan was to flee to the Austrian Netherlands under the protection of Marie Antoinette's brother, Emperor Leopold II. Like many European monarchs, Leopold II was worried about the revolution in France and how it might affect him. On the night of June 20th, 1791, the royal family made their escape. They disguised themselves and traveled in a carriage. However, they were stopped in the town of Varennes, where they were recognized and arrested. To save face, the assembly claimed that the king was taken against his will. However, the discovery of a counter-revolutionary manifesto written by Louis generated worries that a counter-revolutionary Austrian army would soon invade France. The Declaration of Pillnitz by Austria and Prussia, in which they voiced their support for Louis against the revolution, heightened these worries. The king's escape caused a split in the National Assembly between the Jacobin Club and the New Fouillon Club, who wanted a constitutional monarchy. Maximilian Robespierre led the radical Jacobins, who wanted to get rid of the monarchy and make a republic. One Jacobin, Versailles, made a petition to remove Louis XVI as king. On July 17, 1791, many French citizens went to the Champ de Mars in Paris to sign. The National Guard tried to break up the crowd and ended up killing 50 people. The trust between Louis XVI and the revolution was broken, and the monarchy was no longer important.
After the Declaration of Pillnitz, a new group emerged called the Girondins. They believed that the declaration challenged the French Revolution and wanted to protect the Republic by being proactive with expansionist policies. The Girondins quickly pushed for war against Austria, who they saw as a threat to the revolution. King Louis XVI liked the idea, because if France won, he would gain more power, as he would be credited with the victory. If they lost, the foreign armies would put him back in charge. The Girondins were able to secure a declaration of war from Louis against Austria in April 1792. The French army, however, was poorly equipped and poorly trained. The Austrians, joined by the Prussians in June, made significant gains in the early months of the conflict. The situation in France was further complicated by the Brunswick Manifesto, issued by the Duke of Brunswick, the Prussian commander-in-chief, which threatened to destroy Paris if any harm came to the French royal family. The manifesto was a clear attempt to intimidate the French revolutionaries and to undermine their cause. The Brunswick Manifesto had the opposite effect, however, and instead galvanized the French people in support of the revolution.
The Jacobins soon got ready to strike against Louis and the Assembly upon news of the Brunswick Manifesto. Georges Danton, leader of the Cordeliers Club, oversaw the insurrection. First, they invaded the Hôtel de Ville and took over the Assembly. They set up the insurrectionary commune, with Danton as Minister of Justice. Next, the insurrectionists went to the Tuileries Palace. They were supported by armed militiamen and former National Guardsmen. Louis found out about the coming insurrection and went to the Legislative Assembly for safety. The Swiss guards at the palace stood motionless. When the thousands of insurrectionists got to the palace, believing the Swiss showed signs of peace, they were met with gunfire from the Swiss guards. Chaos broke out, and a long battle took place in the palace compound. Eventually, the palace was overrun and the monarchy overthrown. On August 12th, Louis and his family were given to the insurrectionary commune and guarded in the Temple Prison, a small fortress in Paris. The monarchy was suspended, and Louis now just a figurehead.
Following Tuileries Paris, prisons began to fill up. The insurrectionary commune arrested over 1,000 people, including priests, suspected royalists, and even formal royal servants. Paris became a police state. The fall of the city of Verdun to the Prussians on the 2nd of September sparked panic in Paris, and many decided that the important fight was in Paris. That September day, citizens went to the prisons with pikes to man justice. Violence began that afternoon. A mob of sans-culottes, patriotic commoners, went on to kill two-thirds of the population of Abbey prison. At Bicêtre, over 40 miners were slaughtered, the youngest being 12 years of age. At La Salpêtrière, 40 prostitutes were butchered, but not before being sexually assaulted. By the time the massacres wound down on the 7th of September, 1,400 people had been killed. The massacres horrified the rest of Europe, turning many against the revolution. The massacres turned terror and violence into acceptable methods of achieving political goals. In the aftermath of the massacres, each revolutionary faction blamed the other, despite none of them doing anything to stop the killings as they happened.
Charles Dumouriez, a Girondist ally, would be appointed to command an army destined to confront the Prussian invasion. However, the French army was undersupplied, poorly equipped, and lacked discipline. In August 1792, Dumouriez led his 36,000-man army to the Argonne, where he intended to make his stand against the Prussian army. On September 20th, the Prussians came under fire from French artillery situated at Valmy. The French occupied the high ground, and the troops were well-equipped and well-armed regulars. By 2 p.m., most of the Prussian army had assembled. As they got closer, the Prussians were able to hear revolutionary songs of La Marseillaise, bolstering French morale. Brunswick and his army retreated upon the realization that the attack would be fruitless. The victory was a surprise, but it had far-reaching consequences. The French victory at Valmy resulted in the National Convention, formally the Assembly, abolishing the French monarchy and the establishment of the First French Republic. The victory at Valmy prolonged the war, seeing the French take the Austrian Netherlands and win another victory at the Battle of Jemappes in November.
Following the abolition of the monarchy, the National Convention was tasked with deciding what to do with Louis and his family. The Girondins argued that he should be kept as a prisoner. The Mountaineers, a new extremist political group led by those like Robespierre, advocated for the death of Louis. Louis was put on trial for numerous crimes, including conspiring with foreign powers and attempting to flee the country. During his trial, his defense claimed that Louis had already paid for his crimes with his abdication and had committed no more. On January 17th, 1793, the convention voted to execute Louis XVI. His execution took place on January 21st, 1793, to be beheaded by guillotine.
Je meurs, innocent de tous les crimes dont on m'accuse. Je pardonne à ceux qui sont coupables de ma mort, et je prie Dieu pour que le sang que vous allez répandre ne retombe jamais sur la France.
The execution of Louis XVI marked the end of the Bourbon monarchy in France. The execution of a monarch being seen as an extreme and unprecedented act served as a sign for worse things to come. Britain and the Dutch Republic had been watching events in France with concern and had already formed an alliance against the French Republic. However, Louis's execution led to France declaring war on these countries as a preemptive strike, enlarging the first coalition against the French Republic.
Following the king's execution, the Girondins accused the Mountain of having too much control over the revolution. The mountaineers, in turn, accused the Girondins of plotting military dictatorship. In early April, the convention established a committee of public safety. The mountaineers demanded the expulsion of any member who had spoken up against the execution of Louis XVI. The Girondins responded by arresting Jean-Paul Marat, a radical journalist, the president of the Jacobins. The jury soon declared Marat innocent. The Girondins' plan had failed. In May, they called for insurrection against the mountaineers, hoping to rally the sans-culottes to their side. The plan backfired, and instead, the sans-culottes rose up against the Girondins. The National Guard, which had previously been sympathetic to the Girondins, switched sides and joined the insurrection. The Girondins were forced to flee the convention. The Committee of Public Safety, now controlled by Robespierre, took charge of the government and began a campaign targeting the enemies of the revolution. Girondin sympathizers were arrested and executed, along with other perceived enemies of the Republic. The reign of terror had begun.
Charlotte Corday was a woman who lived in Normandy. She was a Republican raised by the Books of Enlightenment. By 1793, she was disgusted by the direction of the French Revolution. She concluded that Marat had to die for the Republic to live. Corday traveled to Paris and brought with her a kitchen knife, then went to Marat's apartment. She wanted to kill Marat in front of the National Convention to maximize her message's impact. However, Marat suffered from a mysterious skin condition and was confined to his bathtub when she arrived. Upon hearing about Corady's lie, about Girondin's plot in Normandy, Marat invited Corady up to his room. She stabbed him dead on the 13th of July. Corady was caught and guillotined soon after. Some saw Marat's assassination as justice, while others saw it as tragedy. Marat became a quasi-saint and was revered with almost cult-like devotion. His heart was removed and placed in an urn, and his remains were interred in the French Pantheon. Corady, on the other hand, became a symbol of resistance to the Jacobins, and was romanticized in paintings, poems, and literature. She proved that women were capable of self-autonomy and of committing political acts.
With the destruction of the Girondin, the Mountain gained unlimited political power. Despite the Mountain's successes, France was on the brink of collapse. Federal revolts erupted in French cities. The coalition armies forced the French on the defensive. Additionally, the economy collapsed, leading the revolutionary working classes demanding affordable bread and increased wages. In September, the Law of Suspects was enacted, allowing for the arrest of anyone who showed support for tyranny, federalism, or were enemies of liberty. The Law of General Maximum was also enacted to make food more affordable. The Committee of Public Safety became the most powerful entity in government. The Committee of Public Safety created local committees of surveillance, which arrested and amassed all suspects within their jurisdiction. Suspects could be anyone denounced by a committee for anything from possessing royalist or Catholic sympathies to hoarding goods. Once announced, a suspect would be taken to prison, and if unlucky, to the Revolutionary Tribunal, where the verdicts were acquittal or execution. The committee used these tools to execute many people. They started with the nobles of the old regime, and then moved on to military leaders who were accused of cowardice. Next, they executed former leaders accused of trying to take control of the revolution, such as Brissot. As the terror continued, Robespierre and his allies used this chance to get rid of their remaining rivals.
In 1793, the Cult of Reason arose in Paris, which was supported by the Hébertists, an extremist faction. The Cult of Reason rejected the existence of God and instead celebrated Enlightenment values. Robespierre denounced the Cult of Reason as atheistic and arranged for the arrests and executions of Hébertists. He then established the Cult of the Supreme Being, which was centered around deism, the belief that a creator exists but refrains interfering in the universe. As Robespierre's power grew, so too did his cult. The French Republic officially adopted the cult of the Supreme Being as the state religion. The cult even had its own festival, which was celebrated on the 8th of June, 1794, in the Champ de Mars in Paris. However, the cult of the Supreme Being was short-lived. By the summer of 1794, Robespierre, increasing paranoia, his attempts to eliminate even his closest allies had alienated many from within the Jacobin movement, who saw him as a threat to their own survival. On the 27th of July in 1794, after accusing members of the National Convention of counter-revolutionary conspiracy, he and several of his closest associates were arrested and executed, bringing an end to the reign of terror. Over 17,000 people had been executed, likely some 10,000 more dying in jail by the time of his execution.
The Thermidorian reaction that followed aimed to stabilize France after the chaos of the preceding years. The new government, called the Directory, tried to separate itself from the radicalism of the Jacobins by removing them from leadership positions and adopting more conservative policies. One of the first things the Directory did was get rid of the law of maximum, as it had contributed to economic chaos. One strategy the Directory approached was forcing cities that they captured during the Revolutionary Wars to send large sums of money to help alleviate debt. The Thermidorian reaction also saw a resurgence of free market capitalism and freedom of religion. However, the Thermidorian reaction was also marked by a harsh crackdown on Jacobin ideology. Many former Jacobins were arrested and executed, and Jacobin clubs were closed down. This time is known as the White Terror. People who had been targeted by the Jacobins during the Reign of Terror wanted revenge, leading to a resurgence of violence and bloodshed.
In the November of 1799, the French Directory came to an end, overthrown by a coup of conspirators who saw it as weak and corrupt. Economic turmoil and political instability within the government led to growing disconnect in France. The need for a new leader to take charge was intensifying, and luckily, France had the perfect candidate that was making a name for himself in Italy and Egypt. Napoleon Bonaparte, a Corsican-born Frenchman, was a brilliant military strategist who had achieved several impressive victories in Italy against the Austrians, which had greatly enhanced his prestige and popularity. His sole companion in Egypt further cemented his reputation as a military genius, and he became a national hero in France. Napoleon's prestige and popularity made him a natural candidate to lead France, and his ambition soon turned to politics. In November 1799, he staged a coup d'état, overthrowing the Directory and established the consulate. Napoleon was the first consul, and he quickly consolidated power, effectively ending the French Revolution.
The French Revolution has had a profound and lasting impact on modern France and the world. Its legacy can be seen in the French emphasis on egalitarianism, liberty, and individual rights and freedoms. The ideas of the revolution soon spread across Europe and the world, leading to many fighting for the cause of freedom and liberty, even to this day. The events and the ideas of the revolution still continue to shape both modern French and global culture and politics, and will likely do so for many years to come.